So thank you for the invitation, giving me the opportunity to show a little bit what we do in research, also to fight cancer using the immune system. I think that's we all want to do this. Maybe we have sometimes different ways and views to how to do it, I think, but we all want the same at the end. I think this is that's why we are all here. And I think at the end is what counts. The results are counting, however you come to them. I think it's not that important. So, but in order to use the immune system, I think we have to understand it also. So we need to do a little bit of research what the immune system is about. Just to show you where I am, this is Stuttgart, this is Frankfurt, this is Tübingen, a little university town, 80,000 inhabitants, 27,000 students, and a big university hospital with 1,600 beds. So we had some famous people in Tübingen. Melanchthon, Kepler, Hegel were all from our university, the Pope, the current Pope Benedict. And we have a nice castle, and this is the most important kitchen of the world. The castle kitchen, because not known to the world, unfortunately, but in this castle kitchen that was used as a laboratory by the university for physiology, this is where the DNA was found. The first DNA was detected in 1869 by Friedrich Miescher in this castle kitchen in Tübingen. So what would we do nowadays without DNA? So if you come there, and he died before the Nobel Prize was established, so it's never has been known to the world. But the father of immune therapy of cancer is at the same same time. It's William Cooley. Maybe you have heard of him. He was an orthopedic surgeon in the U.S. And what he did, or I have to say, some German surgeons found this earlier already before him. In 1870, there are some publications from German surgeons. They have found when they had an infection after surgery, cancer disappeared. So, and William Cooley had this Cooley toxin where he vaccinated or used it for patients with a mixture of bacteria. And he has seen good responses in especially sarcoma. This is a drawing. At that time, they didn't have the nice cameras yet. So this is a drawing of tumors which he treated. And still, they saw responses. So 1,300 years ago, that the immune system might play an important role to fight cancer. But the immune system, of course, Cooley didn't know of the innate immune system, the adaptive immune system in K cells, T cells. It took 100 years and still will take another 100 years to finally understand probably how the immune system will work. But let's start maybe with the innate immune system, the natural killer cells. This is something you hear a lot. Oh, we can stimulate the NK cells, I think, and with this ingredient, and we can do this to stimulate and to boost the system. But we have to also understand how the system works in order to use it for our purpose. And NK cells have been also known for 100 years already. They have been described by Pappenheim. Maybe you know the staining of blood, the Pappenheim stain. And they have seen this already 100 years ago in the microscope, but they had no idea what these cells are. And NK cells that has been found incidentally, they attack a cell line, this K562, famous cell line. They attack this cell line instantly without any prior knowledge of the cell without sensitization. That's why they are called natural killer cells, and it's a very rapid process. In few minutes, such a cell can kill this tumor cell. So it's a very effective cell. By the way, this is my own NK cell. Yes, yeah, I was younger at that time, but I hope I still have some of them. So. How do we measure these NK cells? We use this K562 erythro leukemia cell line. That's from a patient, from a from a leukemia out of the red blood cell system, erythroleukemia. So we can label this cell line either radioactively with chromium or non-radioactively. And then we add these NK cells to this cell line. And this is now about 5 NK cells per one cell. So we would call this an effector to target ratio of 5:1. Sometimes you see this in the exhibitions. And then these NK cells attack this labeled K562. And this, when this is damaged, this releases the label. And we can use the label, measure the label and the supernatant of this. And this is a measure how the NK cells kill the K562. And this is when we count it. This is how it looks. You see this sometimes in the booklets. This is, for example, a killing now, a specific lysis. 60% of the tumors are killed. This is a laboratory test with an effector to target ratio 40:1, so 40 NK cells per one tumor cells. And when it titrates down, so that's a reliable test. So that's sometimes the test is not functioning. But if you do an NK cell function or have a laboratory where you do NK cell functions, then you should something see like this. Whether the NK cells are important or not has been shown in a Japanese study which has been conducted for many years at 186 to 90. So they have screened more than 3,000 Japanese residents for this NK cell activity, just measuring over the time the NK cell activity. And they have followed them for up to 11 years for incidence of cancer. So they have seen if men had a low NK activity, they had a higher incidence of cancer, all kinds of cancer, the common cancer seen in men, prostate, maybe colon cancer. And those residents who had a high NK activity had a lower incidence. And this was even significant and was very similar in women also. High NK activity, a low NK activity, mean the higher incidence of cancer. So a hint that these NK cells are a surveillance system in our body, which screens, as we sit here, the body for the development probably of potentially malignant cells or cells which might become cancer, and it hopefully eliminates them. But it was not clear how the NK cells can do this. How do the NK cells eliminate these cells in our body? They have to recognize them. How do they do this? And here, the story of the submarine was very helpful. Maybe some of you remember in the 80s, they had some months, there was already some submarines before the coast of Stockholm, and they never catched it. They thought these were Russian submarines, so there was always some conflict there, because that was, of course, forbidden. So they never catched these submarines. And that led people to think, how can we, because whenever somebody saw them, they called the marine, the Swedish marine, but it was too late, the submarine was gone. So they thought about how can we recognize such a submarine? What would be a good tactic? How to do this fast? And this is one tactic where they gave fishers a thick book with thousands of pages with the pictures of all submarines of the whole world. So if they saw a submarine, they had to look in the book. This is maybe a Russian submarine, I call the Marines. So of course you can imagine that this is not very elegant. So they have to carry this thick book all the time. So they had another solution. And this time, the local fishers get only one sheet of paper with the pictures of all the 3 Swedish submarines. They didn't have more, so different brands. And then they instructed the fishers, when you see something in the water and it looks like one of the 3 of these subjects, then do not call the marines. So this is much, much easier, because then it's a fast way to recognize something is strange. They recognize self. So they recognize this is our own Swedish submarine, and this is not foreign, so we don't have to bother. And this is exactly how in Kaysal's book. And this guy, Glass Curry, actually had the idea, and he predicted how in Kaysal's will work, right from this, and this is no kidding, right from this thinking, how to recognize a foreign submarine, how NK-cells could work, and he postulated or hypothesized and predicted how they might work, and the prediction was true. And I'll show you why, how they work. So this is the situation one, when the fishers had to call the marine. This is a very laborsome process, so the the tumor cells has to be recognized by dendritic cells, the antigen had to be presented. Then the T cells had to come in. The T cells can recognize billions of different peptides, means submarines, and then they give the signal maybe, and then they finally kill the tumor cell or they recognize it. This takes for days and days in the immune system. And Glass Curry predicted that NK cells react exactly the opposite way. So NK cells and T cells only kill when they recognize something as foreign. And NK cells kill as long as they do not recognize self cells. And this is what he predicted. And this is true. So all normal cells have proteins on their surface, which are called the human leukocyte antigens, HLA, class 1 antigens. Maybe some of you are in donor registries for stem cell transplantation, or have relatives or have friends who got a stem cell transplantation. This is where you always look for HLA identical donors. This is dependent on this class. And NK cells have receptors, inhibitory receptors, which recognize this class 1. And as long as there is recognition, the NK cells is shut down. So as long as the NK cells recognize the normal cells, it does not kill. But the NK cells is on a continuous modus of killing and in a continuous inhibition as long as she finds this self. And this is not the case. So this is the signal, do not call the marine, because this is one of the Swedish submarines. If this is lacking, if the HLA class 1 is lacking, this and this cell, whatever it is, that can be a virus-infected cell which loses HLA class 1. It's often a tumor cell. It's a very common principle in biology, tumor biology, that tumor cells loses the HLA class 1 antigens for some reasons, maybe reasons of immune escape. And this cell is attacked by these NK cells, whether it's a tumor cell or a virus-infected cell, or even a normal cell which would lose for some reasons this HLA class 1. So the NK cell does not discern between normal and malignant. The signal to kill is the lack of this self-antigen, where the NK cells recognizes own body cells in the body. So actually, this is a very elegant system. If one think about it, it's very rapid. In 15 minutes, this NK cell kill this cell. So it's, I think there cannot be a biological process which is more rapid. And this is why this K562 is such a good target cell, because this is the erythrocytes, our red blood cells, they do not have class 1 antigens. This is physiological. And the precursors of these cells, the erythroblast in the bone marrow, is the only cell in the body which does not express HLA class 1. So that was pure incidental that they used this as a target cell line and found this. That was poor luck for them. Otherwise, they would not have found this whole NK activity. So here it's physiological that these cells does not express this class 1, therefore is attacked by the NK cells, and this is why it's so a good target cells, and this is why the NK cells have been identified as NK cells at all. And that happened also in Sweden, in the Karolinska Institute, some 30 years ago. Of course, everything is more complicated in biology than we would like to have it, and it's getting maybe even more complicated. So these NK cells have a lot of other receptors. These are these receptors, these killer inhibitory receptors for this HLA class 1, where they recognize self from non-self. Then they have some activatory receptors, and they have co-receptors which modulate. So at the end of the day, of course, the NK cells gets all signals from here with different intensity. And whether it's a positive signal or a negative signal depends on the intensity of all these signals. So there is a lot of NK cell modulation going on. And these inhibitory receptors, and this is only known now maybe for 10 years now, so this is also quite recent knowledge. These inhibitory receptors are also inherited in haplotypes. So we inherit everything, of course, from our parents, half from the mother, half from the father. And this is genetically fixed in our body, on our NK cells, which activatory or which inhibitory receptors we have. So this is like the HLA class 1 system, which we all have, HLA. When we need an organ transplant, we want it from a HLA-compatible donor, when we need another transplant. And the killer inhibitory system is also a genetically inherited system, and we have haplotype A and haplotype B. It's not important to know what this exactly is, but about 70% here would be have haplotype B, 30% haplotype A. And important to remember is haplotype B has more of activatory receptors than inhibitory receptors. Haplotype A has only or almost only inhibitory receptors, where the NK cell is rather inhibited. But and don't remember, this is genetically fixed. There is nothing you can do against the genes. You cannot change the genes. But this is important, and just recently it has been reported by a group from Canada that children who had have leukemia, they have more of the haplotype A. So they have less activatory receptors. The NK cell system is maybe less active because of more inhibition. They are more on the brake side than on the gas pedal. And their leukemia can develop more easily. And this has also been reported for a number now, and there are numerous reports coming out more and more in patients with cancer that there is an inherited disposition, susceptibility, maybe to get cancer because your NK cell system is not effective enough to react, recognize foreign or HLA missing cells. So there are, in Hodgkin's lymphoma, it has been shown that these activating receptors had a protective effect, so having tumor inhibition was not good. It has been shown in breast cancer, also here there was activating, was even shown that this this genetic inheritance might trigger breast cancer development. Here they have shown in solid tumors that NK cells have a protective role in lung and kidney cancer, but not in colon cancer. And there are more and more studies coming out, and we do not oversee yet what will be the final, of course, conclusion of that. But your NK cell activity to some extent is genetically fixed. Whether you are have a good surveillance in your body or you have a worse surveillance might be determined from what you've gotten from your parents in terms of the genetic information and in this killer system. And it's a very polymorphic system. This is also interesting. We have no good idea why nature has decided to develop such a polymorphic system in the NK cell, in the NK cell system. So it must, I think, play an important role. And this is in the evolution quite recently. So we are still probably, as we speak, still evolving this system further, because fish who have NK cells already, so lower fish, lower vertebrates have NK cells, they do not have this killer system. Even mice have a quite different system. This has only been shown now in humans and in monkeys, our next relatives. So this is an evolving system, but I think it seems to be an important system. And one more hint that this is very important in our surveillance system for cancer is the fact that if you have these are adult patients who had acute myeloid leukemia, who normally gets a transplant, a bone marrow transplant from another donor, And here, of course, from an HLA identical donor, but here they looked for the Kerr haplotype of these donors. And when they had a transplant from a haplotype B donor, so many activatory receptors, the incidence of relapse was much, much lower in these patients than you had a haplotype A donor. So the NK cell system, which was transferred from the stem cell donor to the patient, controlled the leukemia much, much better, and the survival was much better in those patients who got a transplant from a patient who had activatory receptors. That means a much more effective NK cell system. So this is also, I think, something we have to keep in mind. And even if you have these receptors there, these inhibitory receptors, a lot of tumor cells induce other proteins on their surface, like stress-induced proteins, they induce heat shock proteins, they induce proteins which then also can lead to activation. And at the end of the day, it's the number of the various signals, whether it's a positive or negative signal for the NK cell, whether these NK cells will get activated and kill the tumor cell. So it's not only the whole interaction of these receptors with the cells, but you can overcome, for example, this inhibition by increasing the tumor cells to increase other receptors. And we are trying this, for example, also now there are studies for hyperthermia in some patients, to get hyperthermia, to increase heat shock proteins, because we know that these heat shock proteins will activate the NK cells. So there is now more going on that on the tumor, not only we want to activate the NK cells, we also want to change the tumor cell surface by what we are doing to make them more susceptible for this killing, and this is exactly the reason. And one major mediator of this is our antibodies. antibodies activate NK cells very effectively. They bind with their what we call Fc receptor to the NK cell, and with the antigen binding site to the tumor cell. And antibodies have been shown over the last maybe 10, 20 years as one of the new approaches in cancer therapy. So they have made a good development when you compare it to advances in chemotherapy, where no big advances have been made over the last 20 years. In my setting, for example, where I work in children with leukemia, I still use the same chemotherapeutic drugs in children with leukemia, which have been used 30 years ago already. I just use them in a different sequence. That's the only difference, that they are not really new chemotherapeutica out there, where we think, oh wow, this is something extremely new. But antibodies are coming now in the field more and more, and these are already approved antibodies. Maybe you cannot see it from behind, but these are approved for treatment. This is for chronic lymphocytic leukemia, for colorectal cancer. And of course, these antibodies work different than chemotherapy. They have a completely different approach because they activate the NK cells, or they additionally activate the NK cells to kill that cells where the antibody binds. And this is, of course, why now companies are trying to launch more antibodies into clinical studies. And there is a long list now also. And I think we will hopefully see in the future more of those, because these antibodies have not these side effects like chemotherapy or radiotherapy. So this is something which I think will also lead to advance of the control of cancer by the immune system, by activation of the NK cells. And in our own experience, we have seen these are patients whom with pediatric patients with leukemia who received the allogeneic transplant. This is at the moment for some of these patients the only known cure of their leukemia, and it's a cure, but these patients need a bone marrow transplant. When we measure the NK activity for years after transplant, just as I showed you with this assay, then we see patients who have a low NK activity. This is again this different effector to target ratios, And then we have patients who have, from the beginning after transplant, a very good high NK activity. And when we look what happened to those patients, we see, and this is also significant, that patients with a high NK activity had very much less relapses after transplant than patients with a low NK activity. So again, this NK cell activity these NK cells, of course, these are from the stem cell donor, not from the patient. This is a new immune system, are able to control, at least to some extent, not 100%, to control residual NK cells in the body of the patient and reduce the relapse. And once a patient is beyond this, we consider this patient as cured in leukemia. So this is the good news. So these patients rarely then have another relapse. This is extremely rare in this setting. So again, the NK cell system is very important. And another drug which we use is interleukin 2, also known as proleukin. This is a patient where we measured the NK activity after transplant. It dropped for some reason, we don't know why. And then we thought maybe this patient is in risk of relapse with this low NK activity. So we started to treat these patients with this interleukin 2, low dose IL-2. This is a known drug which stimulates NK cells. And then the NK cell activity of this patient went up to this level she had before. And this patient is still doing fine. But interleukin 2, you have to you inject it subcutaneously. Children do not like this if you three times a week. So we looked around whether there is something which they can just take as a juice. And if you go out there, I'm not a representative of that company. And I was once also on such a conference. I saw how BioBrand stimulates NK cells. So I went to this exhibition stand and said, show me. I want to see it. I worked 20 years with NK cells. Is this true? And then, yeah, we started to see whether this BioBrand, this MGN3, called MGN3, this arabinoxylan, this sugar compound, really activates NK cells, either alone or maybe either together with our known drug, interleukin 2, which is an approved drug, proleukin, which is used, which has been used for a while in cancer treatment. Then it maybe it lost a little bit of hype. Now maybe it's coming back again because we know more on NK cells. So we started to just check whether this BioBrand has any activity on the NK cells. And we did this test, which I showed you, against the K562. This is a control without any. So this is a person, a healthy donor, who has a good NK activity. But you can increase the NK activity by incubation, in vitro incubation, with this MGN3. And as good as with interleukin 2, that was also surprising to us, I have to say. I would not have expected this, that we have such a good NK cell stimulus with this MGN3 extract, with this sugar compound. And even at the lower effector target ratios, where you only here have, of course, this is mathematical, 2.5 NK cells per one tumor cells, you still have a very good killing. It's important to note that once this NK cell kills a tumor cell, they go to another tumor cell and kills it also, and so on. So it's not a one-to-one and the NK cells is done. So this is this NK cell keeps on killing, and we don't know how often she can repeat it until maybe she gets tired. And then we wanted to see whether the NK activity was maybe either synergistically activated by combination of the MGN3 and IL-2. And you can see here, this is the control alone, this is the IL-2, this is the MGN3, the BioBrand extract, and this is the combination of interleukin 2 and the MGN3 sugar. And you see how this goes now almost to 100% killing, so a very effective killing when you combine it. And I have to say, we were also surprised by this result. Then we looked for other tumor cells. This is a hepatoblastoma, this is a liver cancer, where we also have once a while pediatric patients with liver cancer. Here the same, we could increase the NK cell activity. Here the MGN3 was a little bit not as effective as the IL-2, but still much more effective than the control. So there, MGN3 was still effective. This is for rhabdomyosarcoma. We also have a lot of research going on in rhabdomyosarcoma. This is NK cells alone. This is with IL-2, MGN3, and again, the combination with the MGN3 and the IL-2 boosts us a very good NK activity against the rhabdomyosarcoma. Of course, these are cell lines. Then we were interested whether this was all lab work, whether this would be also in healthy persons, what happens if we take the BioBrand ourselves. So we had 10 colleagues who all had to take BioBrand. Of course, it was approved by the ethical committee. We have to do this at the university setting as a study, which is, of course, okay. So we all took BioBrand and then measured our NK activity over the time. And what we could see is also that we could see an increase of our NK activity by taking the BioBrand. So it seems also to work in vivo. So we were quite satisfied that what the claim was, that at least that was true what they wrote in their leaflets there. And then once you stop it, you see, it goes back to the where you started. So it's only activated as long as you take it. And it's still unclear, I think, whether it's better to do this long term or to pause it in between to let the immune system recover. Now, with any activation in the body, you normally get a counter suppression because nothing in the body can activate forever. So you always have a reaction which is again this activation. So sometimes it might be better to stop and restart to let the just the system recover. Otherwise, overstimulation might cause also paralysis of your immune system. This is what you see when you do desensibilization, maybe that you stimulate the immune system continuously with the ones you are allergic against until you are not allergic. So that might happen very similar that you in such approaches. This is a patient, then we do a little study in our hospital with patients with various malignancies, neuroblastomas, all refractory metastasized solid tumors, rhabdomyosarcoma, neuroblastoma, Ewing sarcoma. And I have to say that's why we're doing it, because we do not have alternatives. A patient nowadays, a child with metastasized, let's say, rhabdomyosarcoma or Ewing sarcoma, has a survival chance below 10%. Whatever we do, we give no chemo, we give 5 chemo, we give 10 chemos, it's not getting better. And this is since 20, 30 years. So you can understand we are quite frustrated. So we look now, of course, for other ways. And as I told you at the beginning, if at the end the results are good, we don't mind how they become good, whether it's with BioBrand or anything else, but as long as we make improvements. Whether we make improvements, of course, we have to document, I think, from our point of view in clinical studies, which we do with this also, with BioBrand. So we have here combined the IL-2 because that was the best stimulator, the combination of BioBrand plus the proleukin, the interleukin-2. And you see this is a patient with a very low NK activity with a neuroblastoma. And we could boost in vivo this NK activity almost to 100% in this patient. And it went back to values which are double high as beginning. And maybe here we should stop. This patient got it 3 months in a row. Maybe we should stop here after 4 weeks, pause it, and maybe restart again to maybe get this kind of boost of NK cells. But this is something we still have to find out in clinical research, what's the best way to boost the immune system. Of course, there is always, you solve one question, there are 10 other new ones. This is the problem in research. The disadvantage of NK cells, and this is of course the biggest disadvantage, they have no immunological memory. So they do not recognize the tumor cells as foreign, like T cells do. And this is the big difference to T cells, which is the so-called adaptive immune system. And you all know how effective some vaccination is. In your country, the first vaccines has been introduced, the cowpox vaccine by Jenner, very effectively, also probably by chance. And what Jenner did, he vaccinated his patients, and then the dendritic cells took up this vaccine, and this information was then transferred to the T cells, the CD4 and the CD8 T cells, and these CD8 T cells then become toxic and can attack the target, in this case, the tumor cells. And more important, we have this these T cells can also not only kill the tumor cells, but they can acquire a memory. So these T cells, once they are educated here by this process, they can recognize the T cell, the tumor as foreign, as long as this T cell sticks around, and T cells stick around for a lifelong, or almost. So that's why also in if you get a virus infection, you most likely don't get it a second time, because your immune system is already prepared to interact with this virus. And this is via this system. And of course, the dream is to have the same in tumors, that once you vaccinate somebody against the tumor cells, you have a dormancy maybe for a while, then maybe a tumor cell comes back, regrows, and the immune system would still recognize that regrowing tumor cells and eliminate and fight it. That's also something we want to try to find out how this could work. One approach which is now looked at is the dendritic cell vaccination. The dendritic cells, these are these cells, for example, in our skin, they are called Langerhans cells in our skin. Of course, our skin is the largest organ of our body, and when we have a penetration here with a little infection, we hardly don't see, but if you would see under the microscope what goes on, if you have a little penetration of the skin, what goes on below the skin in terms of dendritic cell activation, they take up the antigen, what's coming through the skin, they present it to the CD8 cell, and the whole immune reaction starts. So the dendritic cells are very important, and these are the central cells. This is why one approach is to use these dendritic cells. We can we can generate them from our blood by incubation of monocytes with certain cytokines here. We can make these dendritic cells, what you normally have in the skin. You can prepare them outside the body in the culture. And then you can incubate them. This is called to pulse them with these peptides, which you think are good against the tumor cell. And then you can either freeze these vaccines and then immunize the patient. And this is shown here in patients with breast cancer, that you can get a T cell response, so a CD8 T cell response, after vaccination with this peptide. So this can be very effective. The problem is here that this panel of peptides which are used here might be good for patient A, but it might not work for patient B, because patient B has maybe a completely different composition of the surface of the cancer cell. And this is maybe one disadvantage of these approaches. So another maybe better approach is what we currently also looking in our university, is that we take the tumor. This is, for example, a kidney tumor. We take the tumor cells, we take a normal cell, the normal cells, part of the kidney in kidney tumors, and then we compare these two tissues for differences. So we do the whole DNA genome sequencing, and then you can find out what differences are there between normal and the tumor cell. This is nowadays very easy with the machines and techniques which is available. It's done in a few days. You can do the DNA sequencing of the whole genome now and find exactly what makes the tumor cell different from the healthy cell. And we know about in tumor cells, we have normally in the range of about 80 mutations in average 80 mutations in a tumor cell compared to the healthy cells. And these 80 mutations made the difference between healthy and normal. And the immune system, if it's good, has to recognize some of these differences. And this is what we can do. We do this. And then we can, from this genetic information, we can prepare an individual cocktail for this patient. This is only for this patient A, but not for the patient B, because this is only for this tumor. The patient B with the same tumor might have only 20 mutations. It's completely other DNA sequences, so it's a highly individualized and specialized therapy here, which takes into account that every tumor from every patient is different. There is no, breast cancer is not breast cancer. If you look on the gene or the genome of these tumor cells, these are so different from each other, it's almost unbelievable how different they are, but all are breast cancer and behave like breast cancer, but for the immune system, they will be very different. So one vaccine for one patient is maybe the wrong one for the other, and it cannot work. So this takes about nowadays from the tumor, this is a peritoneal carcinosis, unfortunately, about 6 weeks to generate this vaccine. And unfortunately, it's associated, at least in our regulatory environments, with a lot of paperwork which you have to fill out. I don't think anybody is reading it, but we have to fill it out anyhow. But of course, this is the disadvantage also nowadays, at least in academic medicine, to do all this paperwork and this overburden regulations. So another approach is done with prostate carcinoma, very similar. Patients with prostate carcinoma, they get this peptide cocktail, the vaccines. And then this is some additional immunostimulants, or we call it adjuvants, to increase, just to mix it together to increase the immunogenicity of the peptide. And this has been done in prostate carcinoma. And again, it was shown that patients, when they got this vaccine, the PSA decreased. This was only one vaccine. Of course, it has to be repeated. So these are ongoing trials. But those patients who had a good CD8 response, this correlated with the clinical response. So those where the immune system could be boosted and the CD8 cells could be stimulated, they were the ones who had a clinical response. And of course, this is the hope that this is associated with a memory response. Only T cells can have an immunological memory, in K cells not, in other cells also not. So the target is this memory response against tumor cells. And just recently published also from Tübingen, a multipeptide immune response against in patients with renal cell carcinoma, just recently, a few weeks ago published, and there it's also shown that those patients had a much better outcome with this vaccination approach. This is the standard treatment, sorafenib. This is a tyrosine kinase inhibitor which is used currently for renal cell carcinoma. This is with a placebo. This is also interesting. There's almost no difference between the standard and the placebo, but this costs about maybe hundreds of thousands of euros. It's good for the company. The difference is only about two months apart, so it's not really a breakthrough, how the companies claim now that this is now the breakthrough treatment. I cannot see this. We have to see whether the vaccination, it seems better, as you can see here. This is this vaccine, and here you see one drawback. This is plus a little chemotherapy. Now you might think, oh, chemotherapy, I think this is no good idea, right? This is in this setting, but this is a low chemotherapy, cyclophosphamide, because whenever you stimulate something, you have a counter stimulation. If you stimulate T cells against a tumor response, the body makes a response. This is called T regulatory T cells, or T reg cells, which dampen this response. So in this little chemotherapy, Cytoxan low dose is a very effective drug to suppress this counter response, this regulatory T cell response, and you see it gets better. When you add it, you have a more effective immune response. So chemotherapy is not only immunosuppressive if you use it wisely and dose it appropriately. It can be also positive to some extent. So not everything on chemotherapy is that bad as you might think. So here, but once we understand the system, then we can use it, of course, much better. And this was also associated with the T cell response. Patients who had a good T cell response, which you can measure in the laboratory, have a much better survival than patients who did not respond. We don't know at the moment why these patients responded and why those patients do not respond. This is something still open, and we have to further look into. I think it has to do with the individuality of the tumor, so because each tumor is very different. Recently, it has been also shown that the T cell infiltration of tumors is predictive for the outcome. This is a histology of a tumor where they count now the infiltrating T cells. I'm not sure whether you can see it very good in the back, but what it says, the more T cells you have in your tumor infiltrating, especially here the CD8 cells, which I showed you, the much better the survival of the patients. So this is also a new view on tumors, that maybe now the pathologist does not only look for the tumor cells, but he looks for the response of the immune system, what's going on in the tumor, which we call now the immunoscore. And that's coming in the last years more and more, that the immunoscore allows us also to predict the prognosis of the patient. This is, for example, if you have a high density and a good immune coordination in the tumor, and there are some other things which you have to look around. VEGF, this has just been mentioned before by Mr. Campbell. He measures it, right? So this plays a role. If this is low, certain T lymphocytes are low, you have a good T cell infiltration of the tumor, your risk of relapse is very low. If you do not have an immune reaction at all in this tumor, or you have ignorance that the immune system just ignores the tumors, your risk of relapse is very high. So the immune system in this setting is extremely important, and this leads to a new view that nowadays the T and M classification is always used, T for tumor, N for lymph node, and M for metastasis, but now we change it to T for memory. So the TM classification, T cell memory, whether we have it or we have it not in the tumor. But to come to the end, this is an extremely individualized therapy. Every patient has his own signature of his tumor, his own set of genes, his different mutations, and you have to somehow have to bring this into account when you treat a patient. That's of course why we see differences. When we treat 100 patients and 20 respond and 80 do not respond, we have no idea why do the 20 respond and the 80 not. There might be some of the reasons, this extreme heterogeneity, and of course much more research will be necessary to find ways to better employ the immune system, but I hope I convinced you that to some extent that the immune system maybe is our most important organ at the moment to fight cancer cells. And how we bring the immune system to a good functioning, of course, this is something which we all have to discuss. I have no good suggestion, but a healthy lifestyle, regular exercise, good food, healthy food, whatever you can think about. And of course, some maybe of the drugs which I have shown you might also be helpful to increase the immune system. And I thank you for your attention.
We consider the variation of tumor cells within a single tumor.
Yes.
Genetically very highly variable.
Yes.
And I think that might be a restriction on your methods.
That this is a good point. there is another variation that in between the tumors there are already differences. And what I have not addressed is maybe what we have to, what these differences make and what our target must be, is the so-called tumor stem cell. So this is the stem cell, has nothing to do with embryonic stem cell, but this is the tumor stem cells where other tumor cells come from. So when you normally do a chemotherapy, you only hit the tumor cells but not the tumor stem cells, and that might account for also this heterogeneity within the tumor. So our target in new therapies must be the tumor stem cell. This is what we have to eradicate. And this seems to be a dormant cell, which is not proliferating a lot. Since it's not proliferating a lot, we do not attack it with chemotherapy. We only can attack proliferating cells with chemotherapy. This is what we see. This is why you lose the hair, you lose the bone marrow function, you get the diarrhea. But the tumor stem cell is a dormant cell. It goes into a state of sleeping, and for some reason then it wakes up again. And this tumor stem cell seems to be different in such a tumor than from the normal cells which just grow. That's a good point. And there is a lot of research now going on to target the tumor stem cell. So we can now identify in some tumors, we can identify the tumor stem cells. In some tumors it's about 1% of all tumor cells is only a tumor stem cell. In some it's more, in some it's less. So it's also depending on the tumor.
You said you had got a raised effect to the NK cells when you transplanted bone marrow.
Yes.
Somebody else, if you had a better ones which were more aggressive.
Yes.
How long does that last?
As I showed you, up to 3 years in that one setting, yes. And when we have patients now where it decreases and goes almost back to zero, we start to treat them. Either now with the interleukin-2, or I also have now started the IL-2 BioBrand combination to reboost it. Because we think it's a bad thing if the NK activity goes down. And what we also see that those patients with low NK cells not only have more relapses, they have more viral infection, because NK cells are also our first defense line against viruses. Our T cell system, when we first encounter a virus, needs about 6 days until it can effectively fight a virus, because of these dendritic cells have to be activated. So this is called a marine, and then they might come or they might not come. Yeah. And the NK cells do it different. They attack right away a virus-infected T-cells. You can recognize it via this lack of missing cells. And this is a very effective way, but without memory. But only the T-cells can get the memory, but then you are protected. So these patients also get less viral infection if they have a good NK cell activity. Yes?
You mentioned about stopping and starting the virus, but can paralyze your immune system.
About?
Stopping and starting.
Yes, yes. I have no clinical data, so I have to give you my gut feeling only. So I would maybe do it about 4 weeks on off schedule like this. But I have no proven data. I mean, I do not have hundreds of patients where this can be tested. But so from understanding the biology of NK cells, that would be a little bit my suggestion, or do it a little bit longer, but then stop it. So there might be overstimulation, and then which leads to paralysis, yes.
Since the causes of cancer are many and varied, whether it's hormonal, whether it's dietary, whether it's stress, etc., etc., do you think the observations that you're making are the result of it or the cause?
That's a question. If I could tell you, maybe I would be a candidate for the Nobel Prize, but I'm not. I'm not. I don't know. This is yet a completely black box, what causes cancer. I think my personal view is that to have these mutations in cells maybe is something we have to live with in our evolution, that DNA makes mistakes, yeah, in the reading frame or whatever. but that our immune system copes with it. That's maybe why we have developed this surveillance system. And when I think that it's a worsening of the immune surveillance, what that the cancer can break out. I think we all have to live with. As we speak, we all maybe have some kind of, maybe not a final form of cancer cells, but cells on the way to getting cancer. In adults, it takes years until you get your cancer diagnosed. In children, it's faster, but this is not that you get on one day a huge tumor with cancer. It's a long process, and the cell has to go through different steps to get it. We know, for example, this is interesting, in children who get AML, acute myelodysplastic leukemia, we have done studies, 10, 15-year-old children who got that disease, we can also, when we go back to the, we do the screening of the newborn blood for genetic diseases, so this blood is frozen, at least in Germany, so we can also find some of the first steps which might lead to cancer in this newborn blood. So that it took about 14 years, 15 years until this child developed cancer. It's a long process. And I think, I personally think it has to do with the surveillance system, which is not working, which might be influenced by stress, hormone, whatever you mentioned. Of course, this is one system. And the immune system might only reflect the other biological functions of the body, which are maybe working or less effective. But it's my personal view. I have no data maybe to show that, because unless we do not know what causes cancer, we will never find out really. But my fear is, even if we know what causes cancer, it will not change our therapy. The problems will stay the same.
Agree with that.
It's good to have that's
I wanted to take note of what you just said, because that was a very powerful statement. I hope everybody heard it. Would you say it one more time, and then I'd like to ask my question, if you don't mind.
What the whole thing?
No.
What? Well, we start from beginning?
This
is my personal Dr. Carlisle.
Kingsley
has a different view. But I fear that even if we would know now what causes these mutations, these 80 mutations which we found in average in a cancer cell, what causes the chromosomes to get nuts and crazy, that our approach will not be influenced by that. We know then. We would have a name for it, but I think we still would have a problem. We would not yet find a therapy for it. But that's my personal view, and of course there are other views, which is fine.
I'd like to ask about natural killer cell activity tests. I've lived in the UK for over 20 years and have been involved with BioBrem for almost 15, and we can't in this country seem to find a test that will test the activity of the NK cell. So we've had people who want to know the difference in their NK cell activity go to Germany and go to America to get those tests. They're like $35 or 35 euros. We can't convince anybody who runs labs here to do those tests. So my question would be, how important is it in terms of cancer survival, this NK cell activity, i.e. anybody here who runs labs, would it be in their interest, and it would be in cancer patients' interest to have that kind of test available here? Alex. how does that activity correlate with cancer survival is really my interest.
I mean, I have shown you the Japanese study where the NK activity had to do with the incidence of cancer, that those women and men with low NK activity had a higher incidence, but there are no studies that you treat now all this healthy persons with low NK activity with something, whatever it is, and you increase it, whether the incidence would go down. So this is something open. But in our patients, as you can see, but we do it, of course, in our research labs, we monitor the NK activity of these patients on a regular basis. especially since we also do this antibody therapy, and their NK cell function is also very important. And patients now, from our current knowledge, what we have, and from our observations, who have a very low NK activity, we would try to increase by either IL-2 or combinations. We have a little study with the BioBrand IL-2, and there are now other drugs coming along which might also be very effective. One is the interleukin 15, which we all are urgently awaiting. So there are some things which stimulates the NK cells even more effectively, maybe. But this is still out there. But what I don't know what the lab is saying.
Well, we're not for interferon gamma, which is related, isn't it? And is a good measure of the immune system. Mm-hmm. I haven't looked into it personally, but it will be my job on Monday.
No, but if there are other tests than this K562, he mentioned the interferon.
That interferon gamma cost over £100 to do, and a patient wouldn't easily be able to access that kind of test if they were already using Viagra, because it's so much.
So from what I understand, you have data to show that if you add the BioBrand and the interleukin 2, you increase NK activity.
Yes.
So do you have data to show that those patients then survive for longer?
This is where we have to wait much longer, of course. This is why we do these ongoing studies. This is why we do it in studies, that we can do the follow-up of these patients. This is maybe the difference than what sometimes has been done otherwise. You treat patients and you say it's worked, but you have no real follow-up of that patient, of this data we are collecting. And you have really to wait long enough until you find whether it's improved. So sometimes we have to wait for years before we make final conclusions. But I think that's most important. That's why we have to do it in clinical studies for the follow-up of the patient, so we don't lose any patient and we follow them, what happens to them.
Do you take patients from the UK who come to you? Someone gets themselves treated by your clinic or your hospital?
We have once a while international patients. We have currently three from the UK, but they undergo stem cell transplantation for a tumor, which is not being done here in the UK at the moment. But it depends on the patients, of course. So we once a while had patients also from the UK or from other countries, but I'm not sure whether you have to come to specifically for BioBrand or anything. This is maybe then you come over and you get the pulver. This is too easy to, huh? There's no reason to travel for that, I think.
Yeah. You said at the end of your talk that our immune system is probably the most significant asset that we have in our capacity to respond to,
yes,
to cancer. And yet, obviously, the vast majority of conventional treatments seem to undermine at least the functioning of the immune system. Can you just talk about that sort of yin-yang that you mentioned earlier, sort of polarity that we have to sort of balance out in this whole...
Of course, I mean, that's the balance is... And I think we all want the same. We want the tumor cell disappear. We might have sometimes different opinion how we come to this. I think not everything in chemotherapy is bad. For example, leukemia, where I can cure now, in 50 years ago, zero patients. Now with chemotherapy, I cure 85% of the patients are cured, long-term cured. So here chemotherapy is good. When I do it in patients with metastasized rhabdomyosarcoma, where I told you the survival is below 10%, whatever we do, we stop to do chemotherapy because, not initially, you have to stop the tumor growth, but then continue with long chemotherapy, because there we also fear that then with the chemotherapy we might do exactly the opposite and damage the tumor cell, the immune system, especially with that knowledge that we see how important, for example, the infiltration of lymphocytes in the tumor is. And if you do this chemotherapy, this patient, there is no infiltration because you wiped out the immune system as well. And this is the yin and yang. You need it to some extent if you have, at least in children or other, if you have become with a fast-growing tumor cell or lymphoma, there is the only way to stop a lymphoma is chemotherapy because it's gone in a week. There is no other alternative at the moment. But the problem is always, what are you doing then when you stop the original growth? And I think there is where this mechanism sets in, and this is where you have to weigh the benefit and maybe the advantage and disadvantage from what you are doing. And I think there we should integrate both ways. It's not the one way or the other way is the correct one. I think there's a combination of the ways we do. And of course, nutrition, that all helps to make the body healthier and stronger. But I fear that with nutrition alone, you don't get a big tumor to disappear. That's once it disappeared or you did surgery and you have residual tumor cells and you bring your immune system to a stage where it can cope with it, that's a different situation. But we have also then sometimes recommendation. We had patients with children with huge tumors were taken to some obscure therapy, and of course these patients died, and they would have a chance with conventional therapy up to 70-80%. So this happens. There was maybe
last question.
Your suggestion that you should pulse the BioBrain is actually quite logical, because there are two other aspects that I can think of.
Can you hear him? Maybe this is important. Oh yeah.
The first is bioidentical progesterone, where you are told that you should not have it all the time. You should have it 21 days after 28. And the other experience of mine is Zolidex for prostate cancer. It can bring the PSA test down very nicely indeed, but people stay on it. And I don't think they should stay on it. Once it's brought down, they should come off the Zolidex, wait for it to go back up again, and then start it again.
Mm-hmm.
And I've had lots of experience of that. And I think it's best if you gain pulse the Zolidex as well as the progesterone.
Yes, there is also one observation from my colleagues, from my dermatology oncologists who deal with a lot of melanoma. So we have the largest melanoma clinic in Germany in our university, not me, but my colleagues. And they have also done vaccines with melanoma, where they do this, they immunize the patients with melanoma, and they have seen if they do this too long, the patients progress faster. No? So if they overstimulate and over-vaccinate the patients, so that might lead to paralysis. So they have stopped this also, this procedure, and do it more on a way to stop it and then restart again, because you always have a counteraction which you have to avoid, or give this little dose Cytoxan, but we don't know a drug which might counteract NK cell suppressive effect at the moment.
That's why I would always say, find the causes, eliminate the causes, and then an awful lot of the cancer will be more successfully treated.
So any hint where I can look?
You sticking around for my talk?